60% of public school children in the state of Arizona today are minorities. That complicates racial integration because there aren't enough white kids to go around. When you look at that 60% number for our public school students, just carry that forward 10 years, 15 years, it's going to change the demographic voting base of this state. And that's what's going on around the country. Immigration is politically destabilizing. President Trump has talked about this. I'm very concerned about this. This immigration today represents an existential threat to the United States. If we don't do something about immigration, very, very soon, the demographics of our country will be irrevocably changed, and we will be a very different country. It will not be the country you were born into.
The border, the detention centers are far safer than the journey that these,
oh my God,
that these that children just came on. And I will say this, you know, people aren't stupid. I spoke to some African Americans who say, gosh, the conditions of the detention center are better than some of the projects that I grew up in. People are looking at this and saying, let's not smear our Border Patrol. They're trying to do the best they can. These children were brought here under horrible, irresponsible circumstances.
Umbrella.
What is good, my people? We are live back again with another episode of The Forecast. Now, I know we're all starting to see the rise in violence when it comes to white supremacy and racism, and the dominant society is starting to step up their game. But the problem is, a lot of us are acting confused as if this is anything new. We're acting as if America hasn't always slaughtered our men, women, and children. I mean, they literally used our babies as alligator bait. But still, after hundreds of years, we act surprised, and we still want to go out and protest. The only time we should be marching and protesting in the streets is to pay homage to what our ancestors did. It's time for our generation to make our own contribution for the next generation after us. Thanks to our ancestors, this is the best time it's ever been for us in America. And yet black children can be harassed or murdered in the streets. In Pittsburgh, an unarmed young 17-year-old brother, Antwon Rose, was shot in the back 3 times by Pittsburgh PD. Now let's see why the police would shoot an unarmed 17-year-old kid in the back as he runs away.
Why are they shooting at him? No, I'm recording this. Why are they shooting? All they did was run and they're shooting at them.
Large crowds of protesters blocked streets in East Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania yesterday, calling for change after an officer shot and killed an unarmed 17-year-old. Cell phone video appears to show Antwon Rose Jr. running from police on Tuesday night. 3 gunshots can be heard. Police say the video might not tell the whole story. Susan Copin of our Pittsburgh station, KDKA, is at East Pittsburgh Police Headquarters. Susan, good morning.
Good morning. This area was filled with demonstrators yesterday. The police officer involved in the shooting has not been identified, but we do know that he was new to the force and had just been sworn in. People in this community are outraged and looking for answers.
What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
Protesters filled the streets, at one point blocking a law enforcement vehicle. They're demanding answers in Tuesday night's fatal police shooting of Antwon Rose Jr., captured on cell phone video.
Why are they shooting at him?
Rose is seen in a light-colored T-shirt and appears to be running away from police. Rose was shot 3 times and died at a local hospital.
Still doesn't even feel real that he's gone.
Allegheny County Police Superintendent Coleman McDonough.
I understand in today's atmosphere, anytime a young man is killed, there's cause for outrage in some areas.
McDonough says the officer involved has been placed on administrative leave as they conduct an independent investigation.
I would urge people to give us time to conduct an objective investigation to gather facts.
McDonough says the vehicle Rose was in matched a car involved in a nearby drive-by shooting.
One person in the car was detained and later released, and police say they found two firearms in the vehicle. But Rose was unarmed as he and another suspect ran away and the officer opened fire. Rose's uncle says he sees rage growing in his community amid reports the officer had just joined the force.
The police officers, I know they got a very hard job and everything, but you know what? You know, you got to be fit for the job.
Superintendent McDonough says the police officers involved did not have body cameras and there were no cameras in the police cars to capture this incident. There is another protest planned for later today, and that third suspect who fled from police is still on the loose. Gail?
Thank you, Susan. It's another upsetting story. I know they said, you know, the video doesn't tell the whole story, but what we're seeing on the video is very disturbing, so I hope they tell the rest of it soon. And I think it's important to point out the officer charged with the shooting, he was new on that force, but he was a veteran officer. He'd worked at other departments for 8 years, so I think it's important to point that out.
Yeah.
He was not a rookie on the job. Very upsetting story.
So, according to the police, they said they got a call about a drive-by shooting. And they believe the car the young brother Antwon Rose was in fit the description of the car involved in the shooting. So they pulled the car over, and as they were arresting the driver, Antwon Rose and another person took off running. So I guess a 17-year-old kid running away the opposite direction caused this cop to fear for his life and shoot him in the back 3 times. They didn't even try to say stop, freeze. The first thing they did was shoot. But they can also write laws that say, well, if somebody's running away, that also justifies shooting them. If somebody breaks into your house, you can't even shoot them in the back if they're running away. But of course, what's supposed to be a trained officer can get away with shooting a teenager in the back. Now, the police are saying they're going to investigate themselves fairly before they decide not to press charges on themselves. But they're already doing what they can to defend themselves, saying they found two guns in the car and an empty clip in his pocket, as if that has anything to do with him getting shot in the back.
Why are they shooting at him?
Shock, outrage, and a lot of unanswered questions this afternoon after police shot and killed a teenage boy. It happened last night in East Pittsburgh. And this afternoon, we are learning new details about the victim and the investigation. Paul Martino is live at Allegheny County Police Headquarters with the latest. Paul?
Yeah, Allegheny County Police, Stacy, now investigating this one, trying to figure out how and why this happened and whether or not it was justified. 17-year-old Antwon Rose fleeing from East Pittsburgh police, shot 3 times in the back. Now, how did this happen? Police say Rose may have been involved in another shooting just moments before they tracked him down. Antwon Rose is one of several Woodland Hills High School students shot and killed in recent years. On Wednesday, Allegheny County Police were dealing with some difficult questions on how and why it happened.
I understand in today's atmosphere, anytime a young man is killed, there's cause for outrage in some areas.
Rose was a passenger in a car suspected in a drive-by shooting moments earlier in North Braddock. East Pittsburgh police pulled the car over and handcuffed the driver. That's when they say Rose and another guy fled from the car. Dramatic cell phone video captured what happened next.
Why did they have to shoot when he's running away? Where is the justification in that? How was you scared when he's running away from you?
Now, county police say it's just too soon to say whether or not this shooting was justified. They're gathering information. They'll turn their findings over to the Allegheny County District Attorney, who will make the ultimate decision in this case. Police still looking for that other suspect who ran from the car. As for the driver at the scene, the guy they handcuffed at the scene, they questioned him and police released him without charging him. We are just now getting new information in about that East Pittsburgh police officer. We are told he had only been on the force just a couple of weeks, was just sworn into duty, although he apparently had law enforcement experience before coming to the East Pittsburgh force. As you can see, a very fluid story. Emotions are running high. Police under pressure to determine exactly what happened here.
Now, the police and media are so quick to cape for these cops, they can't even get their story straight first. And they're putting out a lot of misinformation. The police had to put out a statement. They claim they had video evidence of Antwon Rose shooting a gun, and he had gun residue on his hands. The police had to admit that even though they did have a video, it didn't show Antwon Rose firing a gun. Because you know, if they did have a video like that, that would be the first thing they put out. They also said the information about the gun residue was false. They haven't even got the test back yet. On top of that, they questioned the driver and found out he didn't have anything to do with the shooting. And the car they were in was basically used as a gypsy cab, and they don't know if the brother Antwon Rose was in it at the time or not. And they tried to protect the cop, Officer Michael Rosfeld. They eventually had to release his name.
We continue our coverage of today's headline story. A 17-year-old high school senior was shot and killed by police.
This happened last night in East Pittsburgh, and there are a lot of questions this evening, including whether the shooting was justified and who will make that determination. John Delano found some answers and has them. New at 6.
When a police officer shoots someone, even if they've been involved in a crime in a neighboring community, as has been alleged here, Allegheny County homicide detectives step in.
In accordance with police best practices in the aftermath of officer-involved shootings, Allegheny County Police Department homicide detectives were requested to assume the role of independent investigatory agency.
But it's really up to District Attorney Stephen Zappala to determine whether the shooting of Antwon Rose was justified or not.
That officer has the same rights as any other citizen.
Sources tell me that the East Pittsburgh officer in his 20s has been on duty in East Pittsburgh for just 3 weeks and was sworn in about 90 minutes before the actual shooting, although he's been an officer since 2011.
What I think the community is reacting to right now is a horrible video showing that a young man who absconded from a traffic stop was shot in the back by a police officer.
Beth Pittenger with the City Police Review Board, which has no jurisdiction in this case, says there are lots of unanswered questions.
We have to have the patience to allow the Allegheny County homicide detectives to do their job.
State law allows deadly force in an arrest only when the officer believes such force is necessary to prevent death or serious bodily injury to himself or others, or when force is necessary to prevent an escape and the person to be arrested has committed a forcible felony, or he's attempting to escape and possesses a deadly weapon, or he will endanger others if not arrested right away.
As the investigation progresses, we'll provide the district attorney's office with our findings for his review.
No word on how long that will take.
Now, on his first day on the job, Officer Michael Rosfeld shot a 17-year-old unarmed kid in the back while he was running away. Now, while the media did say he was a cop before, they neglected to mention what happened at his last job. They found out as much dirt on this 17-year-old kid as they could, but didn't say a word about the cop's history. It turns out he was fired earlier in the year for falsifying reports and for violence. But as usual, they get fired or resign from one job for whatever reason and get hired right away at another department. And they get put right back on the street. Now here we are still crying and begging for justice. And they're giving us the same old lines, well, let us get all the facts first. Let us do the investigation before you say anything. After our blood is shed, then they call for peace. And after all this time, we still act surprised, like we don't know they're doing this on purpose. People say Trump is to blame for this rise in racism, but this has been around long before Trump, and we have to accept the fact that we are still in war. It's been hundreds of years, and we still act confused. But every so often, the white supremacist extremists have a spike in violence, and they're doing it to send a message. But we definitely are different from the generations before us. And we have to adapt that American mentality of give me liberty or give me death. They have no problem killing you if you're unarmed running away. So you might as well be armed working together to protect each other. Because they'll think twice about coming into a neighborhood whether people are armed and there to protect the children especially, but protect everybody. We have to realize no matter what we do, they're going to come for us, especially when we're talking about unity or empowering ourselves. They're going to go out of their way to try to destroy it. But we have to respond with more urgency than they do in order to protect ourselves. If we don't, they'll continue to hunt black men down and violate black women and harass black children. But if we don't put aside our tribalisms and whatever gender wars we have, then we're going to be stuck in the same situation.
For the third night in a row, hundreds of people protesting the police shooting death of Antwon Rose. They have taken over the streets and blocked traffic. Hundreds of people rallying on Pittsburgh's north side near PNC Park and Heinz Field. David Highfield is joining us live from that location with the very latest. David.
Yeah, Susan, you were asking me before about Pirates fans being able to leave the game, and you might be able to see there are some Pirates fans trickling around here, trickling around the protest. Now, getting to their cars and getting their cars out of here will be a bit more difficult. You can also see there's a charter bus right over here that has been waiting right here on West General Robinson. He's not going anywhere at this point. Because this whole intersection is blocked. Take a look at it. This is West General Robinson and Tony Dorsett Drive, and this has been blocked like this since before 11 o'clock. And in fact, right before 11 o'clock, a car came through this line of protesters that blocked traffic. Take a look at the protesters now. And all right, we have video of the car. And you can see this car went through a line of protesters, and you can hear people either hitting the car or banging on the car or being hit by the car as this car made its way through. And people started screaming at that point, and that's when the police, who had been keeping a much farther watch, they had a close watch on everything, but they had a farther distance away, they moved in. And you can see police officers here remain with helmets, with billy clubs out. They were in a very straight line, very close to the protesters, and they backed up just a little bit after protesters backed up a little bit. But you can see the protesters continue to chant here. Some of them are arm in arm. They're chanting. You see the folks in the front of the line, they're arm in arm. They're chanting Black Lives Matter. And they're not going anywhere. They're blocking this intersection, and their goal all night has been to create a disturbance. Their goal has been to get attention for their cause. And I will say, for the most part, what we have seen this evening, things have been peaceful, and in fact, police, we've not seen police have to move in at all. At one point, as I said earlier, it appeared that the protesters might try to shut down Route 28, and so they did shut down the entrance ramps to Route 28, and police, reacting to that, also shut down entrance ramps so that no drivers would get stuck on Route 28. But it turns out they did not shut down Route 28, not the way they shut down the parkway last night. Instead, they came back here to PNC Park. The game was in extra innings. It's over now. But they were waiting for that game to end. And now they remain here in this intersection, and police remain here as well. Although, as I say, the situation is eased a little bit from where it was right at the top of this newscast at 11 o'clock, right after that car came through. Now, we're going to remain here. Any new developments, Susan, we will break in again and show them to you immediately. But for now, we'll send it back to you in the studio.
All right, David, watching that video of the car going through the crowd, we could see that barricades were knocked over as folks were chasing that car and punching and kicking the car as it went by, and someone chasing the car falling to the ground. But David reported earlier that as far as he could see from that scene, nobody was physically injured there.
My heart is really heavy right now. There has been public outcries and protests in my city, in my county, and I can't continue to pretend that the lives that we are so casual about in this continual epidemic is normal. It's not a normal day anymore for me. And what I realize as a parent of three, the hardest thing that one could ever receive is a call that your young one will not ever return back. And in this past week, we've celebrated Juneteenth, which was the Freedom Day and the recognition of independence of former enslaved people in this country. And on that same day, we lost a young, talented 17-year-old African-American male, Antwon Rose. And a day later, we lost an inspiring, up-and-coming African-American artist to street violence named Jimmy Walpole. Now, these are just two examples of stuff that happens all over this Commonwealth, all over in every city and borough, and all over this country. And both of them, I call them two tips of a very dangerous spear, and that is black-on-black crime and violence and black-on-blue crime and violence. And both of them need to be addressed and stopped because there are far too many wasted lives that are never reaching their full potential because of these things. And the fact of the matter is, Mr. Speaker, I think what we do here in this hall, in this Capitol, matters tremendously what happens on the ground with these things stopping. And it's not just a financial thing. It's a change in culture. It's a value set that lives matter no matter who they are and what race they come from or what community they come from. And we cannot casually keep closing our eyes and ears to the fact there is a group of people whose lives seemingly don't matter. And when I look at my 12-year-old, I look at my 6-year-old, my 3-year-old, I believe their lives is just as important as any other life. But every time they leave my house, I worry about if they're gonna lose their life. Lose their life by somebody who looks like them or somebody who's afraid of what they think they are or will be. And so as we make these final decisions today, what I wanna also encourage us to do is to look around our communities, question the fact that this system that we currently have isn't working for all of our citizens, that something really needs to change. The conversation itself needs to change. This is about life and death for a group of people who, for some reason, are dying and perishing at far too great a number than what they should be. And so I want to just, before we begin our work today, I had to get that off my chest because I'm at a point now, I'm a loss for words and actions, and I'm trying to keep myself together. Because when I leave up out of this building, I could be the next victim. And all I'm trying to challenge us to do is when we have these conversations, know that there is a problem in our Commonwealth, in our cities, in our boroughs, in our municipalities, and we can't be silent about it anymore.
From Lorain, Ohio this evening, a police officer has been fired after pulling over a car. Inside that car, his own daughter and her boyfriend. He puts the boyfriend in his patrol car, and you're about to hear what the officer then said to him. Here's ABC's Ariel Reshef tonight.
Tonight, the new dash cam video. An Ohio police officer pulling over his daughter's boyfriend.
You can get out. You're going to jail.
John Kovac now fired. His former department saying he abused his authority. The video from last month obtained by the Chronicle Telegram showing the officer apparently threatening to fabricate charges.
Let's see my car. We'll make up as we go.
First, putting the boyfriend into his squad car.
Any guns, knives, weed on you? Go ahead, get smart before I can do something to you even more.
The couple both protesting, saying they're 18. Kovac claiming his daughter was missing.
My daughter in there?
Then forcing her into the back seat.
Why are you taking me? You have to give me a reason. By law, why are you pushing me? Why are you doing this?
Kovac driving away with his daughter yelling.
Let me out of the car.
The department saying Kovac's actions are not acceptable for members of our police department, and we felt it warranted immediate dismissal. Officer Kovac now appealing the decision to fire him. And David, Kovac was a 26-year veteran of the force. Police say they've now handed this incident over to the county prosecutor for review.
St. Petersburg police officer off the job now, admitting to using a racial slur after he was caught on camera doing it. ABC Action News reporter Michael Paluska tonight with the new reaction from the man at the center of this video and what he's now saying about the police department.
That's all.
Unfortunately, this is something we prepare ourselves for growing up as black kids or minorities in certain areas.
Levante Daniel says he wanted us to know the entire backstory of what happened last night because he says that is what led to this video and probationary officer Michael Naples resigning. Around 10 p.m. Monday night, Daniels called 911 after he says a pizza delivery lady tried to hit him with her car.
I grabbed a fire extinguisher. I was scared.
He says the driver was white, so was Officer Naples, and he felt that they didn't believe him.
I said, but sir, I just want to let you know that this is not how this happened, and I want to have record of it. He told me, well, I'll put it all up here. This is what he told me.
Then came the profanity and racial slur.
Once I told him, you know, you're trying to railroad me, he said, yeah, well, you're a piece of shit. And if you hear my reaction, I said, well, you're a piece of shit too. And then he said, well, you're a piece of shit. And that's how that played out.
Yeah, you heard, I got you on record.
This video evidence backs that. St. Pete Chief Anthony Holloway condemning the behavior, telling Naples to resign or be fired. Holloway telling us the pizza delivery driver was not cited.
He explained to Mr. Daniels what happened. Mr. Daniels then admitted to what happened. So again, one person said another thing, Mr. Daniels said another thing.
Like, I feel like I was portrayed in a bad light. We're gonna try and get something done about this driver who tried to hit me with her car, and we're gonna try to get something done about the other two officers who lied and said I was prosecuting somebody and there's no paperwork to prove anything.
Hey, Mr. Samuel?
Yeah.
What caught my attention was this vegetation stuff right here.
I ain't got nothing. So, what is your vegetation?
Let me see that.
What? That's tree stuff, man. Test it. That gotta be from the tree, man.
Okay.
Y'all pulling me off from the...
All right, hold on just a minute. Let me put this in the bag real quick.
Yeah, it's sad, man. What are you... Man, that's from a tree, man. I don't even smoke. This man said vegetation on a car window.
All right, I know y'all seen that. This man picked vegetation.
Sir, you walked up to my car and said you pulled me over. What was the original reason you said you pulled me over?
I already explained that to you.
You told me because I failed to turn.
Step on it for me.
Sir, do you have a reason for me?
I got the vegetation in the window.
That's from the tree, sir. I don't even smoke.
Okay, I'll test it here in a little bit, okay?
No, you gotta test it right now.
I ain't gotta test it right now. I need to step out for me.
Step out for what?
Sir, no. Facebook, y'all. You are. Relax. You're being detained.
For what?
For trying to search the vehicle.
You have to have a reason to search the vehicle.
You got that vegetation in your window.
Who has vegetation on a window sill?
Relax, sir.
Who has vegetation on a window sill? Who has that? Please tell me who has vegetation. You gotta have permission. I'll give no permission, no consent to search my vehicle. You have to test that before you can search my vehicle.
Thank you, sir.
My uncle's a police officer. I'm not stupid, man. I know. Hold up, sir. You know the law just like I do.
All right, and we back on the forecast. Now, we as a community need to do more than just pay attention to history and notice the cycles. We need to start taking actions on those cycles. And the theme of America has always been black destruction, not only physically and mentally, but also sexually. One of the most dangerous groups in America is by far the white woman, because white women have learned how to play the fence. I have no idea how white women are considered a minority when they're the majority of the population in the voter bloc. But they managed to play both sides of the fence. They benefited the most from the civil rights movement, all while helping maintain white supremacy. From the early white feminists like Margaret Sanger, who talked about eugenics, to the second wave feminism in the 60s and 70s that was used to break up the black family, to feminism today in the Me Too witch hunt, or should I say black male hunt. But you'll never hear feminist organizations talk about women like Mary Zolkowski, who looked like she could be a feminist herself. In Michigan, this white girl, Mary Zolkowski, was charged with lying about being raped by a black man.
A woman has now been sent to jail for 45 days for making up a story about being raped by a black man in a Delta College parking lot. I'm talking about 21-year-old Mary Zolkowski, who's been sentenced to not only those 45 days in jail, but also 2 years of probation with 220 days of deferred jail, meaning if she violates probation, she would have to serve 220 additional days. And as we now understand the story, Zolkowski says she was previously sexually assaulted, not anybody on the Delta College campus, not a black guy, but that she was ashamed to come forward initially and ended up apparently projecting a prior sexual assault onto a vague black man on the college campus. It now is unclear whether she was even actually sexually assaulted prior to the accusation of rape that she made against this amorphous black man on the Delta College campus. Police heard her story originally, started investigating it, and found absolutely no evidence whatsoever. They actually did find a black guy with a criminal record on the Delta College campus, brought him in for a polygraph test, which the guy passed, and ultimately, Zolkowski admitted to police that the story is not true. This has to be taken very seriously. And if there's any argument to be made, it's that 45 days isn't enough. And the reason why I think it may not be enough is that the person who could have ended up in prison based on the false rape claim could have gotten 20 years in prison.
Wow.
And the only case for 45 days instead of more for this woman would be that, number one, as prescribed by the law, the max she could have gotten was 6 months for false reporting of a felony. That's how the law is currently written. And number two, her lawyer said that she suffers from bipolar disorder. And I am 100% sensitive to the impact of mental illness on behavior.
Now, this girl, Mary Zolkowski, claimed that this big black man jumped out of nowhere and raped her. Initially, she said she was walking to her car in a back parking lot when a man grabbed her from behind, grabbed her face, grabbed her throat, and proceeded to rape her without a condom. She said when it was over, he took off and jumped into a passenger seat of a car. And it was so fast, she couldn't really get a description of him. All she knew was he was a black man. Now, when the police tried to investigate, she refused to get a physical exam. They even arrested a random black dude and started questioning him about the rape. If this was 1918 and that was his grandfather, they probably would have hung him. But luckily, in this case, the police decided to do more than just take this white girl's word for it. Then when the police talked to her again, she changed her story and said, well, it wasn't this black dude, it was this guy I already knew. But he had text messages from her claiming that she was raped by somebody in a Walmart parking lot. Eventually, she did take a plea deal. And at first, Judge Joseph Sheeran said he wasn't going to give her any jail time, just probation. He ended up sentencing her to 45 days, with 220 days over her head if she violate probation. White women have gotten whole towns destroyed, men, women, and children, based off allegations that 50 years or 100 years later we find out wasn't true at all. That white woman Carolyn Bryan can admit to lying about Emmett Till all those years later, and they still won't do anything to her, even though it's no statute of limitation on murder. And if a black man did rape this white girl, Mary Zolkowski, even though I don't see why any black man would, he'd probably never get out of jail. Until black men and white women and everybody in between is treated equally in the justice system, then we have a problem. But they'll never give a white girl the same time they'll give a black man. You have cases like Gregory Counts and Van Dyke Perry. They were falsely accused of rape and convicted.
But they just kept going on. It's like a locomotive train that was going full throttle.
Gregory Counts and Van Dyke Perry.
I got a lot to talk about. I got like 20, almost 30 years to talk about.
We're in court for the first time since 1991 where they actually got justice.
These two men were convicted of kidnapping, rape, and sodomy because of the testimony of a complainant who recanted her accusations just 2 weeks ago.
Manhattan District Attorney Cy Vance talks about the case of the two men that his office worked with Barry Scheck's Innocence Project and state appellate attorneys to get reversed. Counts and Perry were accused by a woman in Harlem of violently raping her while they drove around in a car back in 1991. Despite DNA evidence produced that pointed to someone else and firm alibis from the two men and inconsistent testimony from the accuser and the car in which the alleged sex crime took place having been broken down at the time, the men were convicted. Perry served a dozen years, Counts 27.
And during that time, I prayed for my life. And I was young, I'm scared to death, I don't know what's going on.
Perry moved to the Pacific Northwest to try and start a new life.
When I was living in the car, I was living in my car with my kids and my wife.
The judge vacated their convictions at last. Now men with records that are clean from a crime that didn't exist say they'll try to live as normal lives as possible.
I can't live off hate. Nobody can live off hate. You know, like I just said earlier inside the courthouse, if I could waste 10 minutes being angry, why can't I waste 10 minutes being happy? I'd rather be 10 minutes happy than 10 minutes angry.
Yeah, hey, I'm not staying in New York no more. They railroaded me for a crime I ain't do. No, I ain't staying out.
Many states do not provide compensation if someone has been wrongfully convicted and incarcerated. New York is not one of those states. You can get compensated for wrongful conviction. Both men intend to pursue that as well as civil cases.
In this case, two black men were convicted. Even though the DNA did not match them and matched up to somebody else, even though they had solid alibis, even though the story from the accuser was inconsistent, even the car she claimed they raped her in was broken down at the time, the state didn't care and they convicted him anyway. Van Dyke Perry ended up doing 10 years and Gregory Counts ended up doing 26 years for a rape he did not commit. And the court didn't care about the truth. And after they served their time, then the woman recanted her story. And after their lives were already ruined, then they were finally exonerated. It's not about fairness or justice. Meanwhile, you have cases like Alec Cook. He admitted to raping at least 3 women and stalking another 2. And he was only given 3 years in jail.
I'm sorry. I was wrong.
A former college student convicted of sexual assault breaks down in tears during his sentencing. 22-year-old Alec Cook had pled guilty to sexually assaulting 3 women and choking or stalking 2 others while a student at the University of Wisconsin.
You told the truth and everyone should believe you. This is my fault.
One of his victims, who didn't want her face to be shown, spoke about her horror.
In some ways, this entire experience has made me forget how to be kind to myself and how to trust myself.
The judge also got emotional as he responded to her victim impact statement.
Please continue to be kind. I'm sorry, and positive. And don't let him take that from you.
Not only did he go to great lengths to let people know that he was following the law, but he also reached out specifically to the victims to let them know their voices were being recognized.
Cook looks dramatically different now than when he was arrested in October 2016. A diary was discovered that contained names of women he was interested in. It lists things like job/major, what makes her special, what's my next step, has it come to an end, and this eerie notation, killed next to an unchecked box. The prosecutor says the diary is evidence of stalking and grooming. When the story first broke, Cook's high school prom date, Megan Couture, spoke exclusively to Inside Edition.
He threw me on a pool table.
Were you afraid of him?
Yeah. I mean, he's really, like, he's a big person. Like, I'm 5'2", and he's well above 6 foot, and like he's just big and powerful.
Back in high school, he was known as Mr. Fingers.
He made sexual advances on my friend where he was just trying to, they were hanging out in her basement, and he would just like try and stick his hand down her pants like repeatedly while she didn't want to.
Though he faced a maximum sentence of 19 years, Cook was sentenced to only 3 years behind bars, partly because the judge took into account he did not have any prior criminal history.
Would you say there's outrage over him just getting 3 years?
Oh, absolutely. People look at the conduct committed here and say, wait a minute, is this enough of a punishment?
Now, this psychopath, Alec Cook, had a diary with detailed information about the women he wanted to rape and how to do it and whether he would kill them or not. He was facing 19 years, but the judge, Stephen Ehlke, showed him some leniency and only gave him 3 years. This judge gave him credit for not having a prior record. But in America, it's easy for white people not to have a prior record. That's a part of the white privilege. He admitted to raping 3 women and stalking another 2, but since he didn't have any priors, it's okay. But this same judge, Stephen Ehlke, gave a black man guilty of sexually assaulting one woman 20 years. And to excuse the racial disparity, they'll try to say, well, it's about money, not about race, as if there isn't a racial disparity in wealth. But it's not about money. Poor white men can get away with what rich black men can't get away with. In Montana, a man admitted to raping his 12-year-old daughter for years. The judge, John McKeon, sentenced him to 60 days with 17 suspended, so he only had to do 43 days. The girl's mother even asked the judge not to send him to jail. And it wasn't because he had money, because he didn't. Because it has nothing to do with wealth. They fear the big bad black man. Yet we constantly excuse it and cape for him. At some point we gotta realize these people don't have our best interests at heart. And we all we got. When black men and women came together and worked together, we actually made something happen. But if we stay divided, we'll continue to lose.
Dyke Perry and Gregory Counts couldn't hold back the emotion and tears as they sat in a Manhattan courtroom today, finally exonerated of a crime they were accused of in 1991.
These two men were convicted of kidnapping, rape, and sodomy because of the testimony of a complainant who recanted her accusations just 2 weeks ago.
The victim claimed that then 21-year-old Perry and 19-year-old Counts kidnapped her from her home in Queens, then drove her to Central Park, where they took turns sexually assaulting her. The victim recanted after both men had already served their sentences. The alleged victim and the convicted men knew each other at the time.
The complainant now admits that her boyfriend forced her to lie and falsely claimed these men sexually assaulted her. Her boyfriend was trying to avoid having to pay a debt to these two men.
Perry was released in 2001 on parole. Counts was finally freed on parole last year after spending more than 25 years behind bars.
It's like a really like a torture I went through, and I know I'm sitting in jail for something I didn't do.
After his release, Perry moved to Washington State to start a new life. He is now married with 6 children and owns a landscaping business.
I got a good life now. It's just that it was kind of hard, man. It was real hard, man.
Despite the exoneration, he says this will haunt him for the rest of his life.
It's never going to be over. The reason why, because it tormented my life and it's my past. You understand?
Counts says that it was his faith and family that helped him get through his jail sentence.
I thank God that at the highest level I give my thanks to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I got my family, and my family stood by me all this time through the whole process.
Both men plan to seek restitution. The Innocence Project took on this case in 2014 and had DNA evidence retested. It matched a man who is now deceased, and the victim admits at the time of the alleged assault, she was a prostitute. In Lower Manhattan, Valerie Castro, CBS 2 News.
Van Dyke Perry says he hopes to establish a youth program to mentor children who are at risk of incarceration.
The former UW student accused of sexually assaulting multiple other students will spend 3 years in prison.
Alec Cook's sentence has many disappointed after 11 victims came forward to tell their stories. Amanda Quintana joins us here in the studio with the reaction from the Rape Crisis Center and one of Cook's former teachers. Amanda?
Yes, Cook will spend 3 years in prison, then 8 years on probation for multiple sexual assault, strangulation, suffocation, and stalking. But the Rape Crisis Center's executive director says Cook essentially got off for his crimes because he came from entitlement and wealth. And this could affect the sexual assault victims who are willing to come forward in the future.
These were really horrible, egregious acts of violence against a number of women. They will be healing from this for the rest of their lives. To see the man who did this to them only serve 3 years in confinement, it's a hard thing to overcome.
The community at the Rape Crisis Center feels both defeated and sad to see 22-year-old Alec Cook receive a short sentence, especially after being in the courtroom.
I was shaken to the core over the possibility that I wasn't his only victim.
Reading a victim's statement to the judge.
It's very difficult for victims to do that. We're asking them to live this over and over and over again.
Executive Director Aaron Thornley Parisi says although only 6% of offenders
serve time, she was hoping the judge would see the need for the justice system to evolve and stand firm against sexual violence.
I think he was basing that on where we were, not where we are now, and where we should need to be moving in the future.
Just as disappointed.
I would say his interactions were odd and somewhat inappropriate.
Alec Cook's former human sexuality professor at the UW.
For students who are upset by this, I don't have a good answer. And I think it's not only a question of justice, it's a question of protecting the community.
After Cook went from being one of her students to the discussion topic in her class, she's not confident in 3 years he won't do this again. And for other victims not seeing the justice they think those 11 students who came forward deserve.
There will be some who will say there's just no point. Others might say, you know, maybe my case will be the one.
The Rape Crisis Center will continue their work, they say, even more now to counteract the effects of cases like this one.
Cold water for $2.
This woman don't want to let a little girl sell some water. She calling police on an 8-year-old little girl. You can hide all you want. The whole world gonna see you, boo.
Yeah, and illegally selling water without a permit?
Yeah. On my property.
It's not your property, right?
This woman don't want to let a little girl sell some water. She calling police on an 8-year-old little girl. You can hide all you want. The whole world gonna see you, boo.
Yeah, and illegally selling water without a permit? Yeah.
On my property.
It's not your property.
Something.
What?
Somebody seen the video on Twitter, right? And guess what?
What?
They know you want to go to Disneyland, and they bought you 4 tickets to go...
Of a white woman reportedly calling police on an 8-year-old black girl selling bottled water near AT&T Park, and it is going viral tonight.
This woman don't want to let a little girl sell some water. She calling police on an 8-year-old little girl. You can hide all you want. The whole world gonna see you, boo.
Yeah, and illegally selling water without a permit? Yeah.
On my property.
It's not your property.
This allegedly happened yesterday near the ballpark. Little girl's older cousin posted the video on Twitter with the hashtag PermitPatty. In the 15-second clip, the cousin follows the woman who was walking away talking on the phone. Many are saying it's similar to what happened last month in Oakland when video surfaced of a white woman calling police on a black family for using a charcoal grill at Lake Merritt. That woman was dubbed Barbecue Becky. Now, we reached out to the woman who posted the latest video, and our Andrea Borba will have her story tonight at 11.
We are staying on top of this story that you saw first on Tube. A Spring ISD elementary school principal accused of making an inappropriate joke about a special needs student. It's a story that a lot of you have been reading and watching on clicktohouston.com. Channel 2 Cion Rhodes live in Spring now with the latest fallout from that controversial comment. Cion?
And the district does say that the principal said it was just a joke, but it's one that many people don't find funny. In fact, they are calling for that principal to be fired. Principal Shanna Swearingen at work this morning as her school community reels from her controversial comments.
See, that kind of comment is disgusting. Even if it was a joke.
Swearingen reportedly apologizing for remarks she made about a special needs student, a young black boy with behavioral issues who is known to run away from school. Swearingen overheard saying, "We won't chase him. We will call the police and tell them he has a gun so they can come faster." Spring ISD said while the comment was made in jest, it was inappropriate and should never have been made.
That person needs to resign or be fired immediately.
Ashton P. Woods with Black Lives Matter Houston says Swearingen was out of line and out of touch with current concerns about police violence and young black men and boys.
Black children are criminalized far too often. What about all the other children who've died because of a toy gun, right? And you're saying that this child has a gun but doesn't, but actually really needs your help, and that's sad.
I would never even hear her speak like that.
Kathy Rodriguez is a member of the Ponderosa PTA and says while she was shocked to hear what Swearingen said, she still supports her.
You know, she apologized for it. She knows, okay, we all make mistakes. We're human. And we all say things sometimes that we shouldn't say. I think that everyone just needs to just come together as they always have here at Ponderosa.
And I asked the district whether the principal would face any disciplinary action for her comments, a spokesperson telling me that they don't comment on personnel matters.
Do you believe discrimination exists in America today?
I have personally never observed it, but many of my friends from the inner city of across America will tell me that it is evident today.
Do you believe that it exists?
I believe it. Like I said, I have never personally observed it.
I understand you've never, and you're very lucky that you've never experienced it.
That's right.
Do you believe that it exists?
Here's what I would say. I believe the people who tell me that it exists.
So discrimination in America exists today?
I stand by my answer.
I have to say your earlier response to Mr. Capuano was stupefying, even jaw-dropping. I was wondering if you were aware of what happened recently in Charlottesville.
To be honest with you, I don't watch TV.
So you didn't read any of the articles in the newspaper?
I don't read a newspaper.
These are unbelievable statements for any adult in America, especially one that took an oath of the office like you did. But let me ask you a couple of questions. So fundamentally, why should the public trust you to overhaul the Community Reinvestment Act, a product of the civil rights movement meant to address generations of segregation and exclusion, if you don't seem really, I mean, you just don't even seem certain that discrimination exists? Will you promise us to move forward on a CRA overhaul only if you have the full support of the civil rights community?
They will be at the table discussing.
I understand they'll be at the table, but some people are at the table and ignored by others at the table. Will you commit to this committee that if there is not unity, if there's not consensus in the civil rights community, you will not move that direction on CRA overhaul?
They will be at the table having discussions like all parties involved in this.
That's the most you're going to commit.
I stand by my answer.
Okay.
There are many people who would say that Joseph Otting spent more time in the inner cities of America than most banking executives across the world.
Yeah, well, that's been you don't have a personal opinion whether there's been any discrimination in banking?
Again, I have not personally observed that.
Mr. Chairman, I yield back. I can't go any further.
Well, that means you probably don't believe a lot of things because you haven't personally experienced nuclear war either. But does nuclear war exist? I mean, I'm not going to get into that. That's a ridiculous answer, but that's okay.
I'll respond over to
1860. Yeah! Yeah! Hey! Fucked up!
Oh, 37 headquarters, shots fired, shots fired. Come on, buddy. Show your hands. Give us your fucking hands.
All right, and we back on the forecast. And I want to say RIP to the young brother, Antwon Rose. They are trying to send a message. They are coming for our women, for our children, for all of us. And there may be a spike in the violence right now, but we can't lose sight of the fact that it's always been like this. It's not like it's new. It's been going on for hundreds of years. They have no problem profiling and harming our children. We have to remember them seeing themselves as superior is based off us being inferior. But we still let white women play both sides of the fence. And we let them benefit the most from the work we put in, all while helping maintain the system of white supremacy. They have no problem sacrificing black people, especially black men, just for the word of a white woman. We saw what happened to Emmett Till. We know what happened in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and Rosewood, Florida. But still, all these years later, and the most punishment they'll get is 6 months. They won't ever respect our lives unless we demand respect, unless we take respect, unless we respond with more urgency than they do so we can protect our children. Until that happens, we'll still be subject to their laws, their rules, and their punishments, and whatever they say goes. So, as always, man, we have got to start standing for something, or we're gonna keep falling for anything.